Carry on my wayward son. There'll be peace when you are done. Lay your weary head to rest. Don't you cry no more.
Hi folks, Dr. H here. Welcome to another session of Music Elements Online. I hope you've been having some fun with the discussion topic and also with accessing the first section of our online music text, the On Music Fundamentals. I wanted to first address a couple of issues that some of you have pointed out to me through email. And by the way, thank you very much for bringing those to my attention. I believe all of the sound issues have been fixed at this point. There was an issue with the online keyboard, but I believe that has been taken care of. If you are still having difficulties hearing any of the lessons or any of the online keyboard functions, any of that, please email me again. And you can also contact the technical support at On Music Fundamentals, or the C4E link at support@connectforeducation.com, or you can visit the Student Help Center link. You can also call them, and they're very helpful, at 703-880-1180, extension 200. So you've got some resources available to you if you are experiencing some technical difficulties. And I apologize if you are, but they should be taken care of by now. So also wanted to bring to your attention that I have updated the extended the deadlines for the first section and the second section. This was done in order to give everybody an opportunity that, as you know, maybe hasn't had the opportunity to get the text until later. So this will give you an opportunity to catch up. Also, anyone who did happen to join the course at a later date, you might not have had access to the online textbook immediately, or you may not have had access to the online the e-learning site. So there are some deadlines, and I have adjusted those. So now the first assignments, the discussion topic, for example, and the introduction, and watching the introduction video, which was due, I believe, on the 27th, is now due February 10th. So you do have some more time to look at those. And also the first section one, Introduction to the Keyboard, is due February 10th. So you've got an extra week in there to play around with that first section and learn those materials. Likewise, I have added dates for section two, which is the musical staff. And so that due date is not until February 17th. So you do have quite a bit of time to complete these classes. The classes are kind of like the assignments. Class four, which has to do with placing notes and naming notes on the staff, and class five, which is the clef cymbals. So I encourage you to take advantage of this time that you have and this extra time in completing these assignments. And of course, as always, if you have questions regarding any of the assignments or accessing any of the materials, please email me and I will do my best to answer your questions and take care of those things for you. Now, the music staff is perhaps one of the more difficult things for non-music readers to grasp. If you are already an experienced reader of music, you know how to read music, then this is going to be old hat to you. This is going to be second nature, and you'll breeze right through it. If you have never read music before, this can be a little daunting, because this is like the language part of music, where music is like a language, and you're learning the rules, the grammar rules. So Essentially, understanding the musical alphabet, which is A through G, and then it repeats. So there's no H, no I, no J. It's just those seven letters, A through G, and then it starts over. And then understanding that the musical staff has five lines and four spaces. And each of the lines and each of the spaces are represented by a letter name. And that letter name represents a pitch or a note. So you've been learning about pitches so far, about tones and things. Now you're going to be learning about the letter names that are assigned to those pitches. You've also learned something called accidentals, the sharp, the flat, and the natural, things like that, and how they affect these pitches. So do pay close attention to how the staff is constructed and about these lines and spaces. And obviously, you're going to have a number of resources available to you. But if you need refreshers, I encourage you to use the ones that are available. For example, one of the links on our e-learning site would be to musictheory.net. You can access that anytime you want, and that goes over everything that we're going to be covering and a whole lot more. But if you want to drill yourself on learning notes, things like that, the perfect way to do it. Also, the supplement to this course, the course pack, it's on our e-learning site. You can download it right there in PDF format. Again, it's a great resource just to sort of, you know, as a companion to what you're learning in our text. So let's take a look at section two together, and we can go over what you're going to be looking at, what you're going to be learning, and if you have any questions, again, please do email me. Okay, here we go. Okay, so here we are looking at the main page of our On Music Fundamentals site. And of course, this is what you will see when you log on to the site. And you can see here is the Getting Started section, section one, the keyboard, and classes. We have class one and class two. These are all ones that you should already be doing if you have not already completed them. And then we get to the next section, which is section two, the musical staff. And we're just going to click on this section overview here and take a look at what they want to tell us. These section overviews have a video, and I just encourage you to both read these opening paragraphs, but also to watch the video. So let's watch this one together, but let's look at this first paragraph that says, to understand music notation, you need to learn how to read notes on the staff. In this section of the course, you will learn how to read music that is notated in the treble clef, the bass clef, and the C clef. Now, don't let this terminology scare you. You're going to learn all about what that means. You will also learn about ledger lines, the grand staff, and basic notational guidelines. So let's just watch this video together.
To understand music notation, you need to learn how to read notes on a staff. In this section of the course, you will learn how to read music that is notated in the treble clef, the bass clef, and the C clef. You will also learn about ledger lines, the grand staff, and basic notational guidelines.
So you've gleaned from that that the little introductory videos that are on our text are just, you know, the verbal and perhaps some visual graphic representation of this paragraph. So, you know, watch it, kind of helps to reinforce what's going on. Okay, so let's go forward now to what are the outlines and objectives of this particular section. To be introduced to the musical staff, also note placement, notation, practicing how to notate, things like that. And then you're going to be introduced to clef symbols. And then, this is a treble clef, this is a bass clef, and a C clef. You're going to get to know what these are, learning about the grand staff. And of course, there'll be a summary that follows at the end that sums everything up. And this is pretty much the condition for each of these sections. So let's proceed on to the first introduction, which is the introduction to the staff. And I'm going to let you read all of this on your own, but I really want to point out this first paragraph because it really is a great introduction. Each of the world's cultures have developed its own forms of language and music. Like a language, music has a written tradition as well as an oral one. In some cultures, music is transmitted and preserved principally through an oral tradition and it is not written down. But other cultures have developed systems of music notation to represent musical sounds and the interpretation of those sounds. Now, this is a fascinating history, one that is not only indigenous to the Eastern Hemisphere back in the in Greco-Roman times and even prior. There has been we've seen evidence of notation. However, in Europe, we did not really have a standardized system of notation, not until around the 1100s and later. And even here in the Americas, the Cherokee Indian actually developed their own system of notation. It's actually quite fascinating to look at. We're not going to learn about Cherokee Indian notation, though. We're going to learn about good old Western Hemisphere notation. But I thought you might enjoy a little brief history. And I encourage you to read these opening statements because they really do help to introduce. But getting down to what it is we're going to learn about, that is the musical staff. You can see here a little grayish outline of five lines and the spaces between, the four spaces. Now, I say to you again and again, clicking on this Show Me button is just absolutely great. If you look at this particular demonstration, you can click on the notes on the lines, and this is showing you what notes look like when they're placed on the lines. Now, let's talk about the notes themselves. We learned a little bit about this in section one, but these ovals, for those of you who read music, you're going to recognize it as a whole note. For those of you who don't read music, well, this is called a note head. So that's what we're looking at right now. The note head is representing a pitch. And we're going to learn that pitch is represented by a letter name eventually. Notes on the spaces. Here you can see when you place a note on a space, it comes between the lines. So I know that might seem like, okay, well, that's sort of obvious, isn't it? Yeah, but for some of us, when we look at notes on lines, we might think that a note sitting on a line is on a line, but no, the line has to be bisecting the note in order for it to be on a line. Again, clicking the Show Me button is going to demonstrate line space, how a note is placed. And you can do this as many times as you like, and hopefully it will be self-evident to you. Again, if you have any difficulties understanding these initial concepts, please do get in touch with me. Now here it talks about note heads. It says some are filled in, some are not, and some note heads have stems and flags attached to them. We're going to learn about all of these when we talk about rhythm. So let's go on to the next little section here. Note placement. Now, again, it says the principal purpose of the staff is to indicate how high or how low a pitch is. This is a concept that you're going to want to grasp right away. You learned about pitch differentiation in the previous section, and I believe I mentioned to you in my first video, if you are not able to discern a high pitch from a low pitch, don't worry about it. It's not really essential for you to be able to do that. However, you might find it a little easier if you can. But if you can't do that, if you can't say, okay, this pitch is higher than this pitch, don't worry. It's not an essential to pass this course. You may not be able to complete some of the quizzes. Don't worry about it. It's fine. But if that is something that you have a struggle with, I would like for you to indicate to me that you are having difficulty or you are unable to discern high pitches from low pitches. And when I say these things about discerning pitches, I'm talking essentially about the keyboard itself. So if you listen to this pitch, for example, and you listen to this pitch, one of them should sound higher than the other. The first pitch I played should sound higher than the second pitch I played. So that's what I'm talking about, the differentiation in pitches. And when you look at the staff, notes that are placed higher on the staff are going to sound higher in pitch. Notes that are placed lower on the staff are going to sound lower. So just making sure you grasp that initial concept. Now, once again, this is talking about placing notes on the staff. If we click the Show Me, it's showing us line space, line space. And it is demonstrating that the higher on the staff, the higher the pitch is. The lower on the staff, the lower the pitch is. That's all it is, just demonstrating. Here you have a discussion on ledger lines. That's because we are not bound by these four lines and four spaces in music. We can write music above and below the five lines and four spaces of any staff. Here you see a treble clef, and you see notes that are written above that staff. Now I'm going to give you another little bit of a side note here. When we talk about the piano keyboard, let me pull up that keyboard one more time. The keyboard is kind of divided evenly, not really, but it is. Here's middle C. And it's called middle C for a couple of reasons, because it happens right in the middle of the keyboard. But generally speaking, notes that are written in the treble staff, in a staff with a treble clef on it, those notes are generally reserved for the right hand of the piano, the right hand playing the piano. And you could say from about middle C up if you wanted to. It actually can go lower than that. But that's a general rule. Treble clef, right hand, the bass clef for the left hand and the lower pitches. Okay? So hopefully that is another frame of reference for you to take a look at. Once again, saying the Show Me shows you these pitches on the keyboard. For example, middle C, you can see where it is on the piano keyboard. Now, if I bring back that keyboard, here's middle C and what it sounds like. This is not showing you where middle C occurs on the staff. This is showing you where this note occurs, which happens to be an F, the topmost F on the musical staff, which is, in fact, right there. That's where it is on the piano keyboard. So let's see what they can show us. So we'll click on the Show Me. So you can see there, it has highlighted those four keys. And then it's showing you the bottom note of the staff, which is E on the bottom line, and going down, there's middle C right there. And this is just showing you, again, in contrary motion, higher you go on the staff, even above it, higher the pitches get. Lower you go on the staff, and even below it, the lower the pitches are. These little lines are called ledger lines, and what their function is just a continuation of the musical staff. It would be very difficult to read music if all the pages were covered in nothing but lines and spaces. We would have such a difficult time trying to discern where pitches were. So we've limited it to five lines and four spaces. That was the standard for the past, about 900 years or so. And using ledger lines to denote pitches that go above the five-line system. Okay, so a couple of other things to look at when you see things like remember, it says do not use any more ledger lines than needed to reach a pitch. Ledger lines are spaced the same as regular staff lines. So once again, there's that idea of the ledger lines being a continuation of the musical staff. Okay, you've got some musical examples here that you can listen to. I'm going to pop my headphones on so I can listen with you, and we'll just take a look at this together. I'm going to let you listen to the Jimbo's Lullaby, but we're going to take a listen to the first C interlude. Let me put my headphones on. And we're going to be able to watch the music as it goes by on the staff. Now, you've already probably noticed there's a contradiction in what I said earlier, that the treble clef is usually reserved for the right hand and the bass clef for the left hand. Here you see an example in this Benjamin Britten work where there are two treble clefs, and both the right and left hand are playing in the treble clef. So that's an exception. And please remember, music is not an exact science. There's always exceptions to every one of these rules. But notice that all of these notes are written above the staff. They are all in ledger lines. Here in the bottom, we see a few of them written with ledger lines, but not as many as what are up here. But the reason being, if these were all written in the bass clef, as would typically be the case in piano music, imagine these ledger lines would be really, really be a lot of them, and it would be very difficult to read. Let's listen to it and watch one more time. Okay, so a wonderful little musical excerpt by the composer Benjamin Britten. I encourage you to look up this work if you'd like to hear more. Also, you've noticed some other things like this lento e tranquillo. You'll see a lot, and dolcissimo. You'll see a lot of Italian terms in music. If you are at any time curious to know what these words mean, shoot me an email. I'll be happy to explain what's going on. These symbols have to do with something in music called dynamics. Now, dynamics is not something that we will be getting into in this course, but if you're curious to know about them, please do shoot me an email and I can give you some definitions that can help you understand the process. Okay, I'll let you listen to Jimbo's Lullaby on your own, but you can see that would be an example of lines, ledger lines that are primarily below the staff. So moving ahead, we're looking at notation practice, and this is placing notes on the staff. And it says notes are written on the staff using oval-shaped note heads that may be either open or filled. The note heads should be slanted upward to the right. Note heads written on a space should fill in the space entirely, just touching the lines above and below. Ladies and gentlemen, if you were doing this by hand, I'm not the note head police. I would not mark you down if you couldn't do it that way. But computers are very exacting. And when you begin to do things like practicing writing notes, you're going to need to do that. You're going to need to make sure your note head is touching, when it's on a space, touching the line below and the line above. So just be careful with it. This is the show me button. This is just showing you what they would look like, where they're being placed, and so forth. You can see here that it's saying that you shouldn't do a circle. I am not entirely sure why they don't want you to do an oval placed horizontally speaking, but you know, there you go. That's just the way they are. I would not mark you down if you were to do that. As long as your music is legible, I'm okay with it. So it's talking about notating stems. I'm going to let you take a look at the rest of these sections on your own. Once again, this is showing you how to write notes on the staff. It is not necessarily showing you what the letter names to the lines and the spaces are. When you learn about clefs, and we'll just take a little look at this first clef, it's showing you where the clefs are and showing you what they do and showing you why they're named what they are. There's the treble, here is the bass, and alto. And I'm going to give you a little bit of a side note about the alto clef and the tenor clef. The alto clef is also known as the C clef. You'll see here it says the alto and tenor clefs are two forms of the movable C clef. It's called movable because you can move this clef up and down, and wherever that center arrow is pointing to, whatever line or space it might be pointing to, is known as middle C. So just experiment with it, play with it. You can see here is the tenor clef. Notice that C is now on the fourth line. If you go back to the alto clef, C is on the third line. The alto clef is also known as the viola clef. And if you play the viola, if you play string instruments, this is, of course, something that you've already learned. Okay, so now we're looking at these clefs from the ideology of what note letter names are associated with each line and each space. And you can see here the treble clef has a series of lines and spaces and notes that are associated with it. If we ask the computer to show us, there's the treble clef showing you where G4 is. It's showing you the treble clef, and now it's showing you what all the notes are on the treble staff. Once again, I encourage you, do this as many times as it takes to get you familiar with all of these notes. Now, when we get to this place, you can begin to play these notes. Notice how it highlights the note as you play it. It highlights whether the note is on a line or on a space. So take some time and experiment with that. I hope that this has given you a good glimpse at what is expected of you with the class 4 and the class 5 of section 2. And again, as always, if you have any questions, please do email me or contact me. Also, I wanted to mention that I do keep regular office hours at the main campus, so if you are on main campus and you would like to come by and see me, by all means, would love to have you stop by. My office is S as in Sam, 239. Take care, folks. Have a great week.